could matter more than this, all that matters. It's our arc. It's an arc on the great scale, the planet Earth. I mean, that's an amazing image, and it's from NASA. I'll give NASA this credit. And no one ever guaranteed that we could step off our planet and look back and see Earth and all that happens there. It does make give us one little bit of fallacy in that we think because we can see it, we understand it, and we really don't. Now, my neighbor is someone that has had that view herself. That's Sunita Pandia Williams, lives next door to me. And in my neighborhood, it always makes me laugh that Sunita is a hero, and she's because mostly she's looking up to the heavens, and my work is more looking down toward that other place. This is the world I'm familiar with, and people like me. We look at the Earth, strip away the clouds, look at all that blue, 70% of our planet covered with water. Average depth, 2 miles or so, about 4,000 meters is the average depth. That's a lot of blue. This is the Pacific Ocean, and you can hardly see any landmass at all. In the upper right, there's little bits of North America. In the lower left, little bits of Australia. But it's an ocean planet. There's an awful lot of water on it. Today, we've explored about 5% of that. So it covers most of the Earth, 70%. And we've explored about 5% of it. So basically, we're living on an unknown planet, this arc that we depend on for the food we eat, the water we drink, the air we breathe. We don't even understand it. It's silly, at the very least. You know, there's an emotional tie. This is Jacques Cousteau, the famous French oceanographer. And Jacques talks about the sea and how it grabs you emotionally. And he launched a whole generation of oceanographers. And yet, we look at a New Yorker cartoon, and there's some ladies having tea, and they say, I don't know why I don't care about the bottom of the ocean, but I don't. So that's part of the problem that we face, is that the oceans pull you. They're very exciting. They're very important. Yet, most of us don't think much about it. And, you know, the question I have is that for you, is what does the ocean mean to you? Because this is the ocean most of us know, from the beach. And you know, beyond the edge of the beach, we don't know what's out there, beyond that horizon. When you think about thousands of kilometers of ocean, and in the past, we used to make all sorts of monsters that lived beyond the edges of the ocean. Then we say that all these monsters are out there because it was unexplored. And even today, we still make monsters. Here's a shark, he's smiling, but still because he's got those big teeth, we make a monster out of this animal. They're fantastic animals. So a lot of what we have in the ocean is a misconception of what's there and how it's important to us. Narwhals, I mean, I had no idea. When I grew up, I thought the Earth had been completely explored. I thought we knew everything. And I thought because of National Geographic, because back then, Encyclopedia Britannica, that I knew pretty much everything out there in the ocean. And then these creatures, I had no idea that something like these ever existed, narwhals. And here's something even more recent that we had no idea. You see that there's a little pool of water sitting there, and it's a view lit by lights from where you're sitting. We'll zoom in on that water, and you see there's some ripple marks in it, some waves and some rocks on the right, and the waves have cut a notch in the rocks. Well, that water that you're seeing there, that pool with the shoreline in the background, with the beach, that's at the bottom of the ocean. In the ocean, we go to the bottom of the ocean in our submarines, and we sometimes find lakes at the bottom of the sea made of super salty water. So that's a lake beneath the sea. And it made me laugh because biologists said right away, it's so salty, nothing can live there. And we said, that's true, except for all the animals that are swimming inside there that don't know about that rule. The ocean's a fantastic place. You know, if we strip away all the water and look at just the topography, the shape of the Earth, in the ocean there, you'll see that there's a mountain range. It's a gray line that moves through the middle of the Atlantic, and it comes up into the Indian Ocean and heads into the Red Sea and then in the Pacific Ocean as well. It's the greatest mountain range on Earth. It dwarfs every other mountain range. Thousands of peaks higher than the Himalayas and the Alps. 70,000 miles long. Most of the volcanoes on Earth are on that mountain range. It's crisscrossed by thousands of valleys, wider and deeper than the greatest valleys on Earth. Some of those valleys are thousands of kilometers long. They're called fracture zones. And again, I have to stress that we've only explored, we've made maps of pretty much the whole ocean, but we've only explored a very little bit about it. Why? Because it's so deep. Average depth, as I said, is about 4,000 meters. It's so vast. So we have to build all the new technologies. And these are some of the ones that we build at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. And, you know, it's not just about the technologies. It's about the people that build them. This is Hanumat Singh. He's an amazing scientist at Woods Hole, building his robots. I think he's doing some of the most exciting underwater research on this planet today. His interest right now is how do we send robots in, around, and beneath the ice caps of the Earth, which are very important. So people are so important. And so it's not just the technology, it's the people. Those are the real heroes, by the way. I don't like when Discovery Channel or National Geographic tries to make heroes. I've been in that position too, and I'm privileged to stand on the stage. But it's people whose names you never hear are the true heroes when you go out to sea and do exploration at the bottom of the ocean. They're fantastic individuals. So let me give you a glimpse of what it's like to go out to sea. This is the ship Atlantis, and it's the mothership to the submarine called Elven. So we're in the age of robots, but still, sometimes we go personally in that submarine. And in this case, there's three people inside the submarine being pulled out onto the deck of a ship, and everyone asking the very important question, should I have gone to the bathroom one more time? Because it's a long day. It's about a 10-hour day, and the three of you are in a very tight capsule. There is a bathroom. It's a bottle. That's it for men and women both. So over the back of the ship you go, three of you, in this little spaceship, inner spaceship. And when you get to this moment, it's an amazing thing. The sound of the ship fades away. That lovely color blue penetrates inside the submarine. And you start to hear the pinging of the sonar that goes to the bottom and back up. And the divers check out the front of the sub. You get the okay, all the gears in place, the scientific equipment, go. And then you float down, three of you, unattached to the surface in any way, into this unbelievable world. You go through light blue, deep blue, and after a half an hour, pitch black. So for about 2 hours, constantly black on the way to the bottom. And we were sure, I was taught when I grew up, there should be no life if there's no sun. There can't be any life. And yet, when we go into that world now and turn on our lights and stop and look, we find all sorts of animals. This one's amazing. It's a very complicated animal. It's got fishing lures and body segments and a little jet thrusters in its head and a light. And fully grown, it would be longer than the stage is wide. So it's an amazing animal. And we wouldn't have a prayer of collecting that in the net and having it stay together. It would fall apart. These animals are too delicate. So we need to go in there and find them where they live. And when we do, we find that that blanket of water where we said there'd be no life at all is full of life. It's incredible. Every expedition that comes back from that, looking at that part of our world, is totally stunned by what they find. Titanic. I never thought I'd get involved with Titanic. I went to Woods Hole Oceanographic just after it was discovered, but I co-led the last expedition to Titanic. It's an amazing thing. I'm just going to show you this one image that was painted by Ken Marcel. It's done by a painter because we didn't have the technology to actually bring that picture to you. We could bring you little bits of Titanic, but to see it like this, we didn't have the technology. Now we do, and we're building the true virtual Titanic, so you'll be able to drive around Titanic and explore it the same way we could. Titanic's a great thing, and we didn't go there to just make a movie or make a documentary. We went there because every single year, about 14 ships this size of Titanic, they're not passenger liners, they're cargo ships and tankers, but every year about 14 on average sink somewhere out in the middle of the ocean. And in the past, we would commit the ship and the souls for eternity to the deep, but now no shipwreck is beyond our reach, so we can get to any shipwreck and study it and find out why it sank, and we're learning how to do that from Titanic. So it's a great natural laboratory. The top of that mountain range, what you're looking at here that looks like smoke is actually hot water. It's incredibly toxic. It would kill everybody in this room like that. And so again, we were positive. Too deep, 4,000 meters, too poisonous. Nothing can live there. Well, we're absolutely wrong about that. When we go there, we find that place is full of life, all sorts of bizarre animals. And in terms of these animals, they're living off that chemical energy. They're actually living off the stuff that would kill us. This incredible toxicity, small animals, big animals like these octopuses. There's more life there, where we said there should be no life at all. There's more life there than the tropical rainforest on Earth. So what amazes me is that in our exploration of the oceans, we find these things that we never ever predicted, the lake, the mountains, the valleys, the animals that live along those hot springs. It's just an amazing, for me, it's been an absolutely amazing journey. Every single day has been just one amazement after another. So that's the fun, that's the good part about exploring the oceans. It's not all the deep water, though. This is my friend Roger Hanlon, studies shallow water. Even there, we're learning, we're getting wise. Instead of running around, we sit in one spot and watch. And Roger studies how animals camouflage themselves, especially cephalopods, octopuses. And here's one scene that Roger collected. So Roger's swimming up to this algae that you see on the left. And in a moment, you're going to see, there he is. That's amazing. That's a very big octopus staring at the camera. And there he scoots away once he's been seen, and Roger paddles and catches up to that octopus. Again, some of the most fascinating work, and it's done in shallow water. So even in the shallow water, even along the coastline, we're learning. And it just amazes us. This is going to go backwards, in slow motion backwards. It's hard to believe that that animal on the right can turn into that stuff, the algae on the left. And yet, because it can change its color and texture of its skin, in no time at all, in real time, it disappears and it's gone. So the ocean is this amazing place, and that's a great part about ocean exploration, always amazing. But there's another part of ocean exploration. It's the 7 billion of us that live on this planet, and we need the ocean. We know today the headlines, even though we haven't explored at all, the headlines are the air we breathe, every other breath of fresh air you take, you can thank the ocean for. It makes the oxygen, 50% comes out of the ocean. The food we eat, more than 1.5 billion people depend on the ocean directly for food. The water we drink, so water is so important to us that 80 to 90% of the rainfall on this planet is controlled by the ocean. And you know that from living here in India, how dependent you are on the monsoon and predicting the monsoons. And you remember how the octopus, we said it's hard to believe the octopus could change into that stuff on the left. Well, in this case, you can't see us on here, 7 billion of us. We're just like a virus or a bacteria, but we've managed through our behavior. We've changed the chemistry and the temperature of the oceans. And anyone with a aquarium knows that if you do that, you're asking for trouble. So it's funny, in our ocean exploration, we're learning that as humans, no matter where we live, the oceans impact our everyday life. Whether it's here in Kochi or the middle of North America, the oceans impact your everyday life. And conversely, no matter where you live, you impact the oceans. So we have this intimate relationship on this arc with the oceans, a thing that we don't even know well at all. It's in our own best interest to understand it. And you know, during the daylight, you don't see us on the planet Earth, but at nighttime, turn out the lights, there we are. I've turned out the sun, there we are. The Earth lights up with our activity. That's North America. That's Europe. You can see Spain on the left side of the map. And in the right, the upper right, those are gas flares. The brightest thing on Earth from space are gas flares from burning off natural gas during oil exploration. Fishing fleets, those blue clouds, those between Japan and China and Korea, are fishing fleets. That's how many there are. It's almost like we're waging war on life in the sea. We need to understand better how to manage our fisheries. This is Africa at night, which is amazing. The gold, every gold dot you see are village fires. So they're not so much electricity, but fire is burning solids for heat, for cooking, for light. And what really gets to me is that there's about 1.5 to 2 billion peoples from the middle of Africa up through the Middle East and into Asia that lack one thing. They're clinging to life because of one thing they lack, something that we take for granted, and that's fresh water. India, to me, from space, is one of the most beautiful sights. I love looking at the lights of India. It's almost like a jeweled crown. So we wondered, on this planet, how can you have 2 billion people that lack fresh water? It's the water planet. And so we decided, let's see how much water there really is on Earth. We took all the water off the planet. That's the Earth with no water on it. And the ball on the left, the big ball that you see sitting there, is all the water on Earth. All the ocean water, all the ice caps. And you could say, well, wait a minute. You know, how can that be? You said it was 70% covered with water. So if the Earth was the size of a soccer ball, all of the water on the Earth would fit into a ping pong ball, a table tennis ball. Imagine trying to take that little bit of water and put it on the soccer ball. It's thinner than the paint. It's thinner than the frost on a glass. And that's because when you think about the ocean, say, I said there were a couple, 4 kilometers deep. Well, they're tens of thousands of kilometers wide. In miles, a couple of miles deep, but 10,000 miles wide, the Pacific Ocean. So think of that layer, thousands this way, but only 2 deep. So yes, we're covered with a lot of water, but there's very little water on the planet. The amazing thing to me is that little dot to the right of the big ball that sits in the northwestern corner of India, that's all the fresh water on Earth. That is it, that little tiny dot. And for us to live the way we do as a species on this planet, we have to have the right amount of rainfall in just the right place at just the right time of year, or everything gets to go up, everything's upside down, and whole societies can collapse. And that, where it rains, where it doesn't rain, how much it rains, is really controlled by the ocean, by this thing that we've hardly explored. My friend Richard Werman, he founded TED, he's got a saying that says, understanding precedes action. And so if we're going to learn how to manage the future better on this planet, we better learn how to... First, explore the oceans and learn how to manage how we interact with the ocean. I love this image. This is an image of the Indian Ocean. Of all the oceans on Earth, the Indian Ocean, to me, is one of the most fascinating. And you can see the light blue on the left side That's just like the seams of a baseball. That's that mountain range. It's some of the most beautiful peaks under the sea are there along that mountain range. Some of the deepest valleys are there along that mountain range. I've been there with our robots and with our systems and made maps of those mountain ranges. They're fantastic, and there's some great research going on there. Apart from that, you have India used to be, not where it is today, but used to be down near where Madagascar is. And some 75 million years ago, India decided to head north and is still heading north. So it hit into Asia, made the Himalayas, hit so hard that it made Lake Baikal, which holds 20% of the world's fresh water, is because India hit China so hard it cracked the entire continent. So it's one of the deepest gashes on Earth. So we have so much to learn from the Indian Ocean, not just about the monsoon, that's incredibly important, but also about what's going on deep inside the ocean about the seafloor. So when you come back to this thing we take for granted, this view of Earth from space, there's two things. One is a quote by Marcel Proust, who says that the true voyage of exploration is not so much in seeking new landscapes, which we do as oceanographers. We're exploring, we find new mountains, we find new valleys, we find lakes. So he says it's not so much in seeking new landscapes as is in having new eyes. And in this case, the idea is that new technology lets us see the ocean and this planet to allow us to think about it differently for the first time. Over the last couple decades, that happened to me. I thought the whole planet had been explored. And thanks to new technology, I'm learning that it's still unexplored, but wow, there's some amazing things out there that turn out to be incredibly important to us. And today, one thing I realized, when I said in the beginning, what could be more important than this? What could matter more than Earth? And the answer is us. It's how you treat me, how I treat you, how we treat each other. And when you look at the Earth from this distance and recognize that this is our ark, this is where we live, you realize that that becomes the truth, that we need to learn not only how to live on this planet, but how to live with each other better. Thank you very much. Thank you.